Okay, so we're moving on after a technical difficulty with the next lecture, which is CSV less complicated.
I'm Marijn, but nobody can pronounce that, so I'm Tux. Everybody knows me, I'm Tux. I'm doing configure work on the Perl core. I'm also doing other things in the Perl core, but I'm also known for my CSV obsession, and I wrote Text CSV XS. And the questions I get lately is, how can I go on after encountering this problem? Well, if you encounter that problem, your CSV is so broken you can't go on. Yeah, but I want to go on because I know the rest is. That's one of the problems. The other problem is, I noticed on Perl Monks, I joined Perl Monks just to see what problems people experience with my modules, and one of the things that came up is, it's too complicated. I want to have it done things my way, more simple, more user-friendly, more end-user-friendly. So less complicated might not be the good title. It might be for the end-user or for the big public. So it made me think, how can I make the future of Text CSV more usable for the wide audience? And this is a quote from Lady Alina. I don't know if she's here and who she is in real life, but she's quite fixed-minded. She has a problem, and she has a solution in which her solution is not how to do it, but what to come out of it. And if there's nothing that will do exactly that, she writes something new. Completely broken, but it fixes her problem. Well, that's not what we want in CPAN world. We want solutions that are workable, trustworthy, reliable, and for general public use. So what I'm going to present is not always a sequence that is logic. It's the sequence of what I did last year in this module. When I took over, that was version 0.2.3, there was a lot of bugs in that. And I joined Perl Monks to see what people wanted, to see what I wanted. And I fixed those bugs and I added those features. But the defaults are still the defaults from then. Can you read this? It's small. I can try to make it a bit bigger. CSV parsing is done in a semi-object-oriented way. You make a CSV parsing object, and you use a get line to go through the file handle to get your lines. Why does it do it that way and not while diamond operator? Because CSV can have embedded new lines, and that will fail always. And people who say, yeah, writing a CSV parser is so simple. You showed me your code yesterday. Yeah. The first three lines were wrong. The first three lines. That's why it's so difficult. It really is. So, new get line. And I can see why Lady Alina has a problem with that. CSV writing is almost the same. You have a new, you select something and you do a print. So it's close to how Perl people think, but it's not close to the end user problem solution. Then there is a whole bunch of options, some of which are ridiculously insane, like binary. The default is zero. Why? Because the original module is binary zero. It breaks UTF-8. Most of the CSV files by now are UTF-8. So we want the binary to be 1. Autodiag. Whoever used CSVXS in the past, did you know about Autodiag? It will show you exactly what you did wrong and where. So you should use it. So that should be a default. But because of all the backward incompatibilities, they're not. So what we want to have is a new function or method or something that is usable, uses same defaults, but makes it very, very simple to the end user. Again, I'm taking you through a way of thinking. So not all the development was in a healthy sequence. Some things were reverted and then re-implemented later. So these two are wrong, plain wrong. So my new function should change that, still using the old parser. So I don't want those options. I want to strike them and make their, for writing, you need to pass an EOL, end of line. Otherwise, it will just punch all the data after another. On reading, you don't want the end of line, because it will then allow you new line, carry you to new line, or carry you turn. So it's much more open to different formats. So we'll take those out. And then we take the rest out, and we want, what we really want, is a function where you say, I want to open that file, and return me an array of arrays, a reference. So it reads the file. That is what Lady Alina wants. No, that's not what she wants, but I come back to that later. At least this is a call she wants. Well, this is something anybody can understand. For writing, I'll also pass the new optional function, and I say CSV, out is test.csv, in is, who uses DBI? Someone using DBI? Do you know the select all array ref?
Yep.
Okay, so this is a dump from foo into a test.csv in one line. Isn't that cool? This will fail if it's huge. We'll come back to that later, because this one doesn't fit into memory. It's not that it won't be able to write, it doesn't fit into memory. CSV parsing. So, we have now a new function. This was my first implementation. I want to do something new. So, we have the optional CSV function, not a method. It returns an array of arrays for a file called test.csv, and I can now just pass through the array. Easy. Much easier to document, much easier to explain. Yeah, but I want headers. Okay, headers auto, and now I have an array of hashes. Expensive. But I can now use the field names. Same function, but it's do what I want. CSV writing. Output file, input handle, which is an array of arrays, but you can also use select, oh, this is an array ref, but you can also use a hash ref. And it will automatically detect that there are headers and write them. You can combine them, because CSV in returns an array of arrays, which you can pass to an output the writing handle as an in, because it's also an array of arrays. So you can write output new CSV in the parsing of the old CSV. So it fixes your quotation probably and make it consistent. What if you get a Dutch CSV file with semicolons? Well, we tell it that the input file has semicolons and the output file has no options, so it's the default. So this converts the old file with semicolons to the new file correctly quoted with commas. Jump in time. It's January this year. And Ricardo, RTBS, the pumpkin for Perl 5, this was his tweet. Okay, I have to open that. He said, Tux, huh, that. Well, I'm curious, so I opened it, and it was this tweet. URI fragment identifiers for text CSV media type. I thought CSV was dead. It's a the whole definition of CSV fits to 1A4. So what's there new to do in CSV? Well, I'll come to that later. There's something new that's coming on. But at the 17th of January, this tweet was gone. 2 days later, I read it. It's a whole bunch of code, but the most important things is that you can say, I want that file, only columns 1 and 2, or you want a cell-based and data CSV, cell is 4,1, and you can barely combine things. So you can do either columns, either rows, or cells, or cell ranges. And cell ranges might be fun. So I thought, we're doing Perl, this cannot be that hard, is it? 2 days later, I had this. CSV, text CSV XS now supports fragments. RFC 7111 fragments. And you have an IO handle, and a specification, and you get back an array of arrays. So you have column names, name H, and you get the CSV fragment, and it's so simple to implement, a simple thing. Okay, the docs are huge, because the RFC is huge, but the implication is simple, and you've got the RFC into something where it belongs. Feedback. So I told them, that was 3 days later, I think. This was 17th of January, this was 21st, so 4 days later. I did, what? So they said it was freaking cool and whatever, and then I started discussing with them on CSV and through mail, and it proved in the end that the RFC is not strict enough. The RFCs are standards, internet standards, and it's not strict enough. I did something other than they thought it would define, and I followed the rules strictly. So there will be a new RFC now. So we can combine the new thing, the fragments. I'm open for questions any moment. You can combine the fragments with the new function. Is this clear? Going too fast, or?
So a fragment is a subset of something inside the column.
Yes. If you a fragment can be two rows, two columns, or one row, or one cell, or four cells, or a combination of four cells with two other cells. That's a fragment.
Multi-cell,
multi-rows, multi-columns, but not columns and rows fragments and cells. So it's either columns or rows or cells. The problem with what they did is, I won't fill the data, they didn't define well enough what... shift... How do I go... So what this will do, because in a CSV it's not defined that every line has to have the same amount of records, of fields. So are these two undefined or not shipped? Is this 5? Okay. What do we do here? Is it leading? Do we have to fill leading or not? Because these start before that. And what about this? The specifications allow that, but there is no definition of what it should do. The only definition in the RFC is that if you are unable to give back what the specification is, or you don't understand the specification, you can return undef. Right. Okay. So this has been the biggest discussion. This is also possible. Yeah, so there's all kinds of possible combinations in fragments, and it's not clear from the RFC what we have to do with this, these blanks. Read the current documentation of what you have installed of TechCSVXS, of what I decided to do at that point. Callbacks. Something completely different, but hooking in on the question of people who are saying, I'm having this problem and I want to go on. Yeah, but I cannot build that into my code. If it's wrong at that point, I cannot continue because I have no idea what the state is. What do I have to expect? A separation character, a quotation character, an escaping character, and a file, new line? I have no idea. So, starting with the idea of callbacks, I first started with, I have this, like a spreadsheet, and I want that as a spreadsheet. What you see is, I added an ID, I kept the date, I dropped this field, kept that one, I combined those, and I dropped that one, right? I presented it as a spreadsheet, but there's a CSV in the back. So the normal way what you would do is you open the file with an object, not with the new function. You have binary, out to diag, end of line. I open the have. I print the new header through the method. I get one line. If row 4 is defined, I change row 3 to add row 4 between parents. And then I print the new records. Everybody ever used record number, which is relatively new? So it remembers what line you are on, but as it's not Perl lines, but CSV lines, which can you have the record number. And this produces that. I can see what Lady Alina means with, this is too complicated. Okay, it's not really easy, but at least it's portable. I read the file. I have no objects at all at this moment. But I have a callback. And I can say, after parse, this is before it returns your data back to Perl level. So it parses, and it has, after the parse, a list of fields it parsed for that line, for that record. What it returns to you, it calls the sub you pass to the callback with the current parser. You can ignore it, but you can also keep it to do tricky things with it. And the row it has parsed. So everything already is parsed. So you have fields. You can change the encoding of the fields. You can get data back for it. Then I say row, that's the same. And I unshift. In the XS level, remember this is a hook, so before it returns the data to you, I can modify it, the record number. I want only columns 1, 2, 4, and 5. Yes, I combine it with the fragments that I already made. And there's my new data. It gets easier. Then, when I gave this part of the talk in Amsterdam, Abed said, well, I see use in this. When I parse it, I have a CSV file with something that went on from a log, and I want it has IDs, and I want to get the IDs from the database at the moment of parsing. I have nothing to do with the IDs. I want the product name. So, what he wanted is something like, I have this as a log file, or a transaction log, or a CSV dump from transactions, with the transaction, the quantity, and the product. And I call them purchases. I skip the headers. I don't care about the headers. I have an after parse sub that pushes as extra fields there, get desk and price, which is a function from a module or your own function or whatever, with the first, the quantity, and the product. But the product I get off. That one returns the description and the price of the product. So what I get back is the transaction ID, which I left intact, the quantity, which I left intact, the product I popped, and it is replaced by the two things returned from the function. Teddy bear black, the price, and the total. So this function can be somewhere else. Now you see more use, more productional use for callbacks, because you don't write the code in the callback itself, but you call functions that replace data in your parse data for something useful. And you can then give it up to someone else. So, seeing the light in that, onIn is an alias for callbacks after parse. Out by now is a new development, is optional. So default, if anything, if it's a void context and there is expected to be something out and there is no out, it's standard out. How easy is this compared to the first draft I showed you? This is something Lady Alina would love to see, but it still doesn't fix her problem. The module I used here was my products. Imagine this is a database. The function is, I just fill it, because it's a reference, I can just fill in the entities. Dumping a database. I'm going a bit fast, so don't hesitate to ask. I connect, I make a SQL statement, I prepare it, and I execute it. Simple. Foo is a huge table. Huge. Millions of records. Won't fit into your memory. It has 75 fields, so star will be a lot of fields. I open a foo.csv, and I write a binary handle, and I fetch the key names, and I do a fetch, and I print. That's the old way. Looping, 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 printing. Done. Using a CSV function with all in memory, I can do out is foo, in is, this will hurt, if not fail. But I have callbacks. And with the callbacks functionality, I can now implement that in refers to a sub, which will tell CSV this will return one row at the time. A sub will return one row at a time. The out is defined. All the options are default, are sane, are useful, but you can overrule them. And what it will do, it will call this function until it fails, and write the output of that function using print. So this whole block is now that block. And there is no memory limit, because it's a loop. Attributes. It is meant to be dwimmish, do what I mean, which is hard. If you ask someone, what will this do? Yeah, but you can also do, yeah, but what that conflicts with, yeah, you're right. But we can fix that by, so, the first draft should be the correct one. If I ship this with wrong implementation, it will fire back at me. So, what I implemented is, I can have, for parsing, I can have a file. So if you pass a plain string No reference is a plain string. It will be interpreted as a file, and it will open that file for reading. You can also put in a file handle. Open my dollar file handle, and so on and so on. You can also put glob. If the glob has a file handle, it will use that. You can also use the old Perl 4, Perl 5 early reference. It will also work. But you can also put a reference to a scalar, and it will open that one as being a scalar IO stream. You can have headers. There is no default. Headers is only useful in three ways. Either you skip them, like I want only the raw data and I don't care what's on top. Auto, so it will read the data and use that as headers for hash reference. Or an array ref, in which you specify the headers yourself. The fourth option is skip. There are headers in my file, but I don't want to see them. Then you can use encoding. So this is the file, and I want to use it, open it as UTF-8. Mind you, there is one problem, and those who have just attended Leon's talk will know that this combined with that will not work yet. I hope to get a session with Leon looking at the code that opens my input stream like a scalar reference and still be able to use the encoding. Otherwise, you have to do something else. And of course, you can use a fragment. So that's the input. Then it uses bin mode. And the bin mode is local.
So this one overrides the encoding set on the file.
Yes, and because the CSV function will parse to the end of file, the bin mode for that file isn't useful for the file anymore when it returns, because the file handle is already parsed. The only problem is when you have a piped system where you write to the file handle, pass the file handle to the CSV function, which reads till the end, then come back and then write to the file handle again, which is an insane process, but it is possible. Maybe it's a good remark, and maybe I should fix that by reading the Perl.io stack and restore that after encoding. I don't know if this will still work. No, but I can use pop. So if the encoding was passed, I can bin mode the encoding, and when I'm done, I pop the encoding. So it will be the previous one. Yeah, so I don't think it will work, but it is an insane idea anyway. More on the parsing part. It's very simple. When you want to print, the key for printing, one character more. Is that you define out. The other key is that if you not define out, but you want print, that it's either one of these three will set out to standard out. So the input, if it's an array, a reference of array refs, a reference of hash refs, or a sub, it will say, well, that can never, ever give you the same back. Then you should have copied it. That's illogical. So these three inputs will cause it to print. Output can be a file name, a file handle, or a glob, a reference to a glob, or a scalar output. That will not work with encoding. Again, sorry, I tried, I really tried, but it will crash. Headers is the same as here. Of course, on print, you don't have fragment. Questions so far? You see, it's building on what I have, and new ideas, and presenting, and the sub was an idea from Sawyer X. He said, well, you had all types of the glob, why not allow a sub? And what would this sub be useful for? And then we went on thinking, well, you can, if it's a sub, you can return a single row from whatever, a database, and then you go on and on. So
I never noticed a bug not in this module. I was wondering if the same is present. So you have a header, and let's say two columns with exactly the same name.
A hash ref will fail.
It will fail here as well.
Yep. And it's documented like that. So if it has two headers, it will probably take the second column with the same header.
Okay, so
that's why it allows headers to be an array ref, so you can put your own headers that replace the old ones.
Well, wouldn't you, instead of in that situation, you could just put them 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, like reference the headers with a number because they are some things before the other, so you can just make up a header so you don't have the
I understand what you say, but I also see the performance implications. I will come back to the performance implications later, but I won't do that. It's a healthy idea, but it's easier to say you cannot have two columns with the same name. Or if you have, you define your own headers. So what you could do is read the first line, detect that there are multiple headers, change the second one, use it as column names because you have to. You can get back after parse. You can get the parser, so you can fiddle with that. You've got all the hooks you want.
Well, there is workarounds. I have done some workarounds. I was wondering.
No, by default, it's not. Then, several mentioned UTF-8, which is the new world. TextCSVXS is a state machine that works on bytes. It never ever knew about characters that were multibyte. It reversed them to being the encoding and passed them byte by byte. Then after it detected the whole field was parsed and it was valid UTF-8, it would set UTF-8 so Perl would not see it. So it would promote the field to be UTF-8. You could disable that. Encode UTF-8 can be disabled. That is useful if you have images in CSV which happen to be valid UTF-8, which are, of course, not UTF-8, but binary data. You don't want to decode them. No, not like you don't. But there is a use for Unicode separation characters, quotation characters, maybe even newline characters. So far, I didn't do escape characters, but I don't think that's useful. So, something that is very interesting for the visual people that visually look at CSV files is using the invisible separator, Unicode character, to print one row which contained two fields, 1, 2. If I print use this, it prints 1, 2. Perfectly valid CSV with two fields. It really is. If you dump it, you see that there's a character between there. It has the one, it has the Unicode character, invisible separator, and it has the two and a character to a new line. Isn't that great? You also use the Arabic comma as a separation character. And I use that as a quotation character. And I give them two fields, a one, and something with a space that will be automatically quoted. So it uses the quote, which is not a normal quote, but it looks like a double quote. And I use the Arabic comma, which is not a comma. So if you pass this to Microsoft, because it looks like valid CSV, doesn't it? It will say, this is data, this is binary data. Yes, it is. But it's valid CSV. I was doing so much in this area that I hated to type Perl minus M TextCSVXS is CSV. Blah, 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 blah. Then I used DataPeak to dump things, and I used JSON to see the structures. So I thought, well, this should be simpler. So I created this small module. It was not this long at first. It was only begin CSV, TextCSVXS, ended. Used this. So the first version of this module was three lines, this line, and this line. So I could use from the command line Perl minus M CSV minus E CSV, whatever. And it will prompt you for wrongishness, like Perl minus mcsv, warn command line. I use now the jcsv, but I could also use csv, it doesn't matter, in something wrong. This is wrong csv, it cannot be parsed. As the default for the new CSV function is autodiag, it will show me because this also sets diag verbose 9, the exact position of where that happened. So when I now prepare this talk or analyze someone else's CSV, I have a command line utility. Okay, it's not a command line, it's a module that looks like a command line utility that will show me exactly what is wrong. If you pass me a CSV file, I just type this with in CSV file name, and it will show me exact what line, what position caused what error. Key. Back to Alina's problem. What she has is a music database. And what she wants is to parse this completely valid data you saw earlier as CSV, and then return a list of hash refs with this first field as a key. Okay, she didn't have numbers as keys, but names or album names or whatever. But she wanted a function that returns this file as this structure. It looks so simple. Why didn't someone else do that? So, of course, in the old days of having text CSV access, you could write your own loop and read the record, put it in a hash. But if your file is not that big, having a key that just refers to the header returns you the whole structure in once as a hash ref is pretty awesome. I know I didn't make the sheet for that, but I want to go back to this. I made three types of callbacks. I've got the after parse, which is after parsing, which I explained. The before print, so you can modify before printing. And error. I didn't want to include it in the whole presentation, but error is something nice. It doesn't return this, but it returns you this and the return of the error diag, which is three fields. The error code, the line number and the position, or the record number and the position. At that point, you can choose, this is error 2023, whatever. I know that it happens, I just skip this record and continue. What you can do in that callback is reset the error code, return nothing, and continue. At that point, the callback sees, I have no error, so I continue. So this is my way of coming towards all those people that say, I want to skip this error. Well, you can, it's your own responsibility that you miss data or modify data or mogrify it, whatever. So there's three types of callbacks. Error can be very handy. The docs are clear on that. UTF-8. Key. This took me about 2 months. Handling UTF-8 in parsing. Printing is very easy to handle separation characters, new line characters, quotation characters, not hard. At the moment you have to put a quote, you just put the encoded sequence for the quotation character. But parsing is much harder because at the first byte, you don't know if it's a separation character. It can just be a binary character inside a quoted field or whatever. But this works now. If you now install TechCSVXS, it was released 5 days ago or 4 days ago, 1.11, you've got separation characters, you've got quotation characters, full UTF-8 compliant. It can be up to 16 bytes. That means you can also use two Unicode characters after another as one separation character. I have no idea how that performs, but okay. Print out in UTF-8, I have the in an array ref with I, Perl. My separation character is a heart. I love Perl. Right. Simple. Sep is the new alias for sepchar. I couldn't use sepchar because the sepchar was not char, it was byte. So it had it needed something new, but it also needed to stand out to the users that it's something new. I also need a new quote char. Quote is easier. It can be multi-byte. You can use a heart, or you can use two dashes, or you can use a top and a dash, or whatever. So in this case, the double heart is a quotation, quote, quote, separator, quote, L, escape, literal heart inside the field, character, character, quotation, separation, quotation, character, separation, quotation. Which will return I love Perl.
Now you have to change the name of CSV to something else because the C is no longer.
No. Correct, but it has the C has always been optional in from the start. Yeah. There's also an XSV module that says it does separation better, but yeah, it's old now. There's also TSV, which also only uses a tab, but that's also simple, and I can now use anything. So DCSV will use a data dumper. This is wrong. It will not show it at that. It will show it as the hex escape. So thanks. That's it, I think. Questions?
I don't know if I looked correctly, but it seemed to me you are numbering the fields from 1, not from 0, in the previous examples. Yeah. In the fragments.
Yeah, page. The fragments has been defined to count from 1, correct. That is the RFC. I cannot help that. I followed the RFC. The fun of RFC, however, is that it defines the star, which means the last field, dynamically. So if your CSV is ragged, so not every line has the same amount of records, it should be dynamically the last field of that line. Star is also allowed for the last line, the last record, but they never wrote down what happens if you say star minus 4. So I can return undef. But you can also say, if it's star minus 4, well, they mean the first till 4, which is stupid. You can also 1 to 4. But there are several inconsistencies in how they define star and overlaps in cells. But yes, that's the RFC. I can help that. I follow RFC.
We had a little discussion about the byte order mark, I think it was yesterday. If you do a file open with a file name, .csv, is that a point where
byte order mark is not supported?
Okay, not at all.
Not at all.
Okay.
How can I get the number and the names of all the column names with the function in the module or by other means?
If you have the CSV handle, the object handle, you can arrow column names. and it will return you the currently used number of headers. If you have parsed it like here, it will return you a hashref, so you can just get the column names from the first entry in the list. So it is an array ref of hashes, and the hashes you can do a keys on.
So it could be used in, for example, form generator, generating input form for a given file.
I think so.
It shouldn't be a problem.
It should not be a problem. And if the header names are a problem, you can also define your own headers, if there are no headers, by using an array ref. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thank you.
And a small question regarding the error. You said it will return the line number and the position in the line.
Yes.
Is it the field number or is it real the actual
byte number?
Byte number. Okay.
And it's on my to-do list to see if the separation characters and quotation characters are Unicode and take more than one byte. Because it's so new, I didn't fix that yet.
Yeah. Would it also be possible to give an indication, if possible, on which field it actually gives an error? I think in handling the error, that would be make more sense than the actual position on the line.
Yes, that's possible. That is a request. Mm-hmm. I never thought about it because the CSV access is about parsing CSV and not about what it gives. This new functionality is also about what it gives, so it makes more sense. Yes, I will take that into account.
Okay.
Just a quick question. I did test CSVSX, and it is quite better performing than the previous one, TextCSV. However, it seems like when it encounters an error, even close to the end of the file, it returns a null value instead of returning the rows it has parsed up to that point.
No, it returns undef indeed because it failed.
Okay, is it possible to return a warning and saying I parsed the file up to this point and then...
Yeah, like an error callback.
Oh, okay.
Yes, it's possible.
It's possible with a callback.
These are the questions that are not stupid, but seen from the technical point of view of parsing, it failed. It really failed. You cannot do anything beyond this point. But if you know the cause and you can use one of those enormous number of options to fix that, you just rerun it.
Okay.
So the first thing I do is use that CSV with AutoDiag and Diag Verbose 9 to see, is it valid? Yes, it parses, no problem, go. And if something fails, yes, you get an error message. Certainly if you're using AutoDiag. If you're not, you have to check and check and check and check and check. Yes, if CSV returns undef or null or something not true, then you have to call the object with the error-diag method to get every information you want. I will think about adding the field number inside the line. I don't know how hard it will be, but might be. I'm over time, otherwise I could have shown you graphs of how I test the speed. The impact of implementing the function is nil. The impact of implementing fragments is nil. The impact of implementing Unicode separation and quotation is about 10% of the speed maximum. So I found that acceptable. It's still 90% faster than CSV. Okay.
All right. Let's thank our speaker. There's a coffee break, a 30-minute coffee break, and then we are continuing with lightning talks in Vitushehal.